My name is Ralph Reusma. I'm from the Netherlands. I'm 42 years old. Started in IT in 1997. Exactly as the previous speaker said, programming. I really liked as a developer, just programming stuff, and it does exactly what you want to do, and it's the feeling of being a god. I still remember my first program that I did on university. But I also realized that working with people, working with processes, gave me more energy. That made me having more fun in my life. So I changed my career a bit, and I went into project management, task management, people management in the end. I always worked at product development companies. Ha, there we are. Yes.
Sorry for this.
Yeah, so this is me. And I'm talking about this at the moment, my personal map. What did I cover? Yeah, always worked in IT since 1997, did Scrum 2004 in the Netherlands with a product development company. I got some women in my life, two daughters. I got a girlfriend from Romania. She didn't want to tell me how old she is, so I had to cross it out. I think 1981 she was born, but don't say that I told her. Now my values in life, in work, are fun. I mean, it should be fun. It should give you energy. It's about transparency. I mean, be honest, be open. It's about professional. If you do something, then also make sure that you do what you say. That's what I really value. And about fairness. I mean, for me, being fair is very important. If I'm not being treated fair, I can really be upset about it. So I also try to treat other people fair. As I said, I worked and I got my own company now, and I know that are two different things. I mean, work and having your own company, being self-employed, is different. It's a way of living. So what I do nowadays, I do Manage 3.0 facilitation workshops, coaching on companies. I'm an agile coach, helping companies to become more agile, Kanban, whatever is necessary, but making them make the next step. Lean change management and also distributed teams. And I'm also involved in Happy Melly, the company behind Manage 3.0. So that's me in short. And this is called the personal map, one of the practices of Manage 3.0. Yeah, one of the first things that I would like to discuss with you is let's make the architect the lead. I bet we got some great developers here on this conference that are the best developers in that team, the best technical leads in the team. Yeah? I think it's working now. And a lot of companies, when they start small, they don't need management. I mean, management, we don't need it. But then they become bigger. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 10 teams. And at one moment, they need to have people managers because they realize we need to do something with management. And the most obvious choice in that case often is, let's make the best guy in the team the manager, because he knows so many things about technical stuff, software, so he has to be good at people management, because yeah, it's how hard can it be? So we're going to make the... sorry, started buzzing, so I was a bit confused. Yeah, so we're going to make the architect the technical lead, the people lead. But he's really good at technical stuff. And within a few weeks, he will discover that working with people is totally different. This is what I experienced at one of my companies where I worked, where I entered as a manager, that the people leads in the company, in the teams, were the architect. And they had every year an end of year review, and they did it quickly, brief, because they didn't like it. They didn't want to hassle with people who were sick or not performing well. I mean, they want to do technical stuff, fun stuff, in their opinion. So that was really a situation that really didn't work out. So we had to change it. So what I did, I asked the technical guys, the architects, the team leads, guys, we have some technical challenges coming up. Would you like to take care of that? Would you like to focus on that? And of course they said yes, because yeah, it's fun. I said, okay, but then I will look for new people leads, because it's also important. And they said, yes, of course it's important, but I will focus on technical stuff. Yes, perfect. So they had an escape without losing their image in the company, to become again more focused on technical stuff. And I look for people in the team who really want to do people management. So that was easy done. I found 8 people who wanted to do with it. But the problem was, or not the problem, we got 8 different levels. People who were just from school, from university, wanted to be people leads because they thought this is really cool. And I got one at least the same experience as me. I mean, he could also be in the department manager, but yeah, for some reason I was it. And then came HR. And I don't want to say HR is evil, but in this case, they were very annoying because they said, we are in a corporate environment, Ralph. We need to have job profiles. I said, okay, I can give you a job profile of a team lead. No, we need job profiles, what they actually do and what they can. Okay, so you need job profiles of the individual levels. Yes. So, but I got 8 different team leads. I mean, they're all different. Yeah, we know. Okay. So I was a bit, what to do with that? Because they request, so basically 8 different job profiles. I could have just done it. I could just, okay, let's make those 8 job profiles. And as I said, I'm a professional. At least I want to act professional. I want to be fair. So I also want to make sure that I got 8 job profiles that really suit the candidates, that fit the team leads, sorry. But that would have taken a lot of time. The other option was, just say, I'm not going to do it. Screw it, HR, I'm not going to do it. I mean, this is ridiculous. But my experience, when you work in a corporate environment, as a manager, as a department manager, it's good to be friends with HR. So that was not really an option. So what I did in the end, I looked at Manager 3.0, and this was before I was really involved in Manager 3.0, and I looked at the 7 levels of delegation. And the 7 levels of delegation in Manager 3.0 are in practice, an idea about talking about delegation. And it's talking about, the first level is about tell. You, as a manager, you tell your people what to do. Exactly, period, no discussion. We're just gonna do it like this. Simple. I mean, this is the easiest style for management. For a manager, you don't just tell people what to do. The second level is sell. Here you're going to try to convince them that the thing that you decided is the best thing for them. They don't need to approve it, bad luck, but this is the best thing that they can do. And you try to sell your idea. The third one is about consult. You really listen sincerely to their opinion, and if they all say we have to go left, then you really consider going left. Because if you're going right every time and they say left, in the end they will say, yeah, screw you, we're not going to give our opinion anymore. So 3 is about really consulting your employees, your team leads, your teams. Level 4, agree. You often see this with hiring. Okay, the manager spoke with the candidate, the team member spoke with the candidate, let's decide if you're going to hire him, yes or no. We all agree or we don't agree. And then we go to level 5, that's advice. And that's where you as a manager, as a team lead, you advise the team. Guys, I think this is the best solution. If you want to look into some new kind of technology, look at the previous talk about new technical stuff, that's what you should do. But it's up to you to decide. I, as a manager, don't decide anymore. Level 6 is inquire. Please try to convince me why you made this solution, this decision. If I don't approve it yet, bad luck for me, is level 6. And level 7 is fully delegate. You figure it out. If you want to change the desk in your office, go ahead. I don't need to know about it. So these are the 7 levels of delegation. And normally you use those with a team. When you talk about who decides on holidays, who decides on new tooling, on office setup, etc. I did it a bit slightly different. And I looked at the things that the team needs need to decide. The people need to be really energized about it. And these are the things that they need to decide on. They need to approve leave. Perform appraisals at the end of the year, do recruitment, regular sick leave, but also long-term sick leave, coaching, sign-off expenses, etc. So these were the areas, the key decision areas that they need to decide on, or I had to do it, but there need to be made decisions on these areas. I just explained to you the levels, so I did a bit of rewriting. Sorry for the screen. Works fine on my PC at home. The team lead, level 1, so the cell, the team lead is not involved in the decision and will be informed by the vice president, that was me in that case, about the decision I made, period. Or I did the task myself. If it was about, I don't know, coaching or whatever, I could have done it myself without informing you. So there were the 7 levels, the first 4. And what I did then, I played a game. I did a simulation with the team members, the team leads. I said, guys, these are the decision areas that you need to decide on. Where do you think you want to be? Which level? How comfortable do you feel about doing things? Afterwards, I had one-to-ones with everybody and I discussed it. So this is, for example, for the most junior team lead that I had. If you talked about review meetings, does this thing have a... Yeah. No, anyways. Review meetings, it was about advice. I advised him how to do it. Appraisals, so end of the year appraisals, that's something that we did together. sick leave of regular leave, top one, you figure it out, I don't want to know about it. The next one, this was the media level, one of the media levels. Sick leave again, you figure it out. For example, recruitment, it moved to advice, agree. The media team levels, team leads, they could do it together with me. The junior guy, I said, okay, what kind of people did you have? And I will make the decision. The most experienced, again, move to the right. For example, underperformance, I would just would advise him. I would do it like this or do it like that. You figure it out for the rest yourself and let me know what you did. Where the previous one, the mid-level, was on level 3. So this gave me a very quick tool to create different job profiles for different levels. In combination with this, where I just described once the levels, I just described once the bonuses, and the only thing I had to do was fill in this matrix with the team leads. Well, we could also use every 3-4 months to review their performance and see, okay, where do you need to improve? Where shall we focus on the next 3 months to improve? Okay, some things to finish this topic up. As I said, you have to review it regularly because you can only use it as a tool to coach people. It's not just a job profile, it's also something to coach people, to make them better. For those who know Scrum, Kanban, you want to move things to the right, to level 7. Because if everything is level 7, you as a manager, you can do other things. You can go on holiday, play golf, or coach other teams. So that's your goal. You're only going to mention areas that you would like to describe something. You're not going to say something about things that you don't care about. Keep it as small as possible. And in the end, you are still the manager. It's not that they can decide themselves to move things to the right. It's something that you do together with them. So it's not that you hand over all control to your team leads. Yeah, this is another case that I had, situation. He's not performing. Fire him. The CTO of a company said, Ralph, do you got a moment? I said, yeah, sure, Bob. And I came to him and he said, I heard that this and this developer is not performing. And he heard it from the architect, who is his friend, so gossip. He's not performing, you need to fix it. Fire him. But, oh, Bob, wait a second. As I said, one of my values is fairness. I don't think it's fair to fire him directly. But I agree with him, we had a case. One of the things that they did at this company is promote people, what we all know about. I mean, it's recognition, giving people more responsibility, also maybe better compensation. But they also did the other way around. They also said we demote people. And if you get a promotion, you're happy, it feels good, it makes you motivated. If you got a mature team, the team is happy for you, it's good for the team. Demoting is everything the other way around. It makes you feel depressive, it makes the team feel sad because what's going on, and in the end it doesn't solve anything. Because, okay, let's make him from a senior developer a media developer. But the team still has the same expectations. I don't know if you work with colleagues, probably yes, but you're not going to check his job profile before you're going to review his code. You have a certain expectation of the work that he delivers. By demoting people, making them media or even junior, you don't solve a problem. And it demotes the whole team regarding motivation. So, no, not an option. As I said, one of the options was fire him. I think it's totally not fair to fire people. I believe that everybody has value for an organization, and it's your job as a manager to find out where they give the most value. So fire him, no way. Create a personal improvement plan. Yeah, a good one. They had in your company, a personal improvement plan where you have to come up with a plan to improve your performance in the next 6 months, and if you don't, then you're fired. That's the idea behind it. So some companies just do it to build a case, so they got a file that they can fire him, that they can tell to the government agencies, yeah, we did everything we could, so we are allowed to fire him, yes, no, yes. I don't like that, definitely not. But you need to create a personal improvement plan to measure people, because it needs to be smart, specific, measurable, attainable, result, or very realistic, and time. How are you going to measure performance of people? How are you going to measure yourself being a good developer? Line of code? Bugs? Unit tests? I don't think so, I don't believe in it. And most of the time, the problems are also in soft skills. So you need to make a plan, and you need to measure that you can really prove that somebody improved his communication. Is that about how many words somebody speaks during the day, how many meetings he attends? So, yeah, no. What I did, I looked around and I came to Champ Frogs, and Champ Frogs is a model for motivation. It consists out of 10 motivators that are related to work. There are more motivators. You have motivators like safety, sex, work, things like that, revenge. Sorry, not work, but revenge. But those things you often don't see at work, at least not where I work. So curiosity, that's the first motivator. This is what you see with technical teams a lot, with technical people, the curiosity to become better developer, better tester. That's the reason why you are here, curiosity, and you learn new things. Honor, how proud are you on your stuff? I mean, the keynote speaker, he was really proud of what he did. So he's on stage for his honor. There's nothing wrong with that. Acceptance, how important is it for you that you're being accepted by the colleagues for who you are? I mean, do you like a dress code or totally not a dress code? Things like that. Mastery, the challenge to get new things on the job, to learn, to improve yourself, to become a better developer, tester. Power, can you influence things around you or is just everything happening? For some people, it's really important to have the influence to change things, to make a difference at the end of the week. That's a motivator. Freedom, that you can decide yourself where you work, which time you start, which tasks you pick up, maybe even which projects you're going to work on. So how important is freedom as a motivator for you? Relatedness. Do you want to go out with your colleagues every week, have a drink on Friday afternoon in the pub, hang out after work, have social media contacts with people at work? For some people, really important, a really big motivator. Order. How important is it for you to have coding standards, to have clear policies in the company? Goal. I worked once with a company in the Netherlands. They created software for primary schools to improve the health of the primary school education system. And they were really proud of that. They really felt connected to that goal, all of them. So that was a really big motivator for them. And the last one is status. I mean, the fact that I'm invited to speak over here, that makes me feel good, that motivates me. That's the reason that I do those kind of things, because I find that an important motivator. So that are 10 motivators. So what I did with this developer, I said, John, can I have a talk with you? I said, let's play this game with the motivators, moving motivators. And which motivator is most important for you? And he came up with these four. I said, let's focus on these four. Because for him, acceptance, that he was accepted by the team, part of the team was really important for him. He really felt that was a big motivator. Honor, he really wants to be proud of his work. Mastery, he wanted to be challenged, he wanted to do new things. And freedom, also, yeah, as I said, he wanted to be a part of a team, but also be able to work independently and pick his own task. I said, okay, that's good. I mean, it's not about judging. I mean, that's it's your motivation. I said, with the current role that you have as a developer, where you get negative feedback from the architect, where there is a buzz around you that you're not performing that well, and he knew that. What does it do with you? He said, acceptance, yeah, it's okay, he said, I mean, people still accept me for who I am. But honor, I mean, I don't feel proud of the things that I do because I get a lot of feedback during the code reviews and from the testers also, so that's really going down. Mastery, they don't allow me to pick up the challenging task anymore on the team, and when I do, they're always checking on me. So also freedom is going down. I said, yeah. That's indeed. What he did a few weeks before this talk was took up the coordination role during release testing sprint. And I don't know how it happened, but he took up that role. So he organized daily test stand-ups to discuss the testing progress. He hunted developers down to fix bugs. He reported to management, okay, what is the progress of the release? How are we doing? How confident are we that we are able to make it? And he did a great job. He really did a great job. So I said, okay, if you look at acceptance, he said, yeah, I mean, it was even outside of my team that they were happy that I came into the room. And I think I really made a difference. I really was proud of the things that I did. Mastery, he said, yeah, it was also new for me. And it's, I mean, I've always been a developer, but doing this testing stuff, I liked it. And freedom, definitely said, I mean, nobody was telling me to do it because it was a completely new role. I said, okay. I said, let's think about this, what you just did, what you just told to me based on this card, and come back after your holiday, because he was going on holiday for a week. He came back. He said, Ralph, I thought about it. I want to take up this new role as test coordinator. I'm going to leave the development behind me. I think it's promotion. I said, way to go. He moved to QA and everybody was happy. The CTO, the architect was happy with this guy's new role, and John himself was also happy. Some questions that I got when I talked about this case, that people asked me, can I make a picture of somebody motivated when they put them on the table? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, that's up to you. If not, then maybe you could wonder what's going on in your team that they don't trust you as a manager. Yeah, this was a really surprising question. Can we build teams with this? If you got five people who are motivated by curiosity, two by mastery, one by freedom, do I have a good team then? I really don't know. But I would say no. Everybody's motivation is different, and the motivation of somebody does not say anything about his team role. As a lead, as a manager, do I have to do this with every employee, with all my team members? I don't know. It's up to you again. I always play this game with my team members when I'm new in a company as a coach, because I want to know what motivates them, what drives them, why do they come to work, what's the reason that they are there. And Manage 3.0, if you know a bit more about it, is about managing the system, not the people. But here I'm talking about individual motivators. How does that connect? True. But when you know what motivates people, you know where to focus. And if all of your developers, all of your employees are motivated by curiosity, by mastery, maybe you should organize some kind of internal conference. Or maybe a change con like King ICT does. If people are really triggered by status, by honor, by doing a thing like this, you give your own employees also the option to come on stage. That triggers their status and honors. And that's how you can motivate people. It's almost December. Who of you has in a few months his end of year review with his manager?
It's not widespread in Croatia.
Oh, I said just one. It's totally not, or?
Not very widespread.
But it's also not regularly, it's just not done. Yeah. Okay, not done. Now, you're the lucky one then. You have a meeting at the end of the year, you're with your manager. And I think when you have those meetings with your team leads, after 1, 2, 3 years, you know exactly what's going to happen. Because you start to know your employees, your team members. And it's not going to be a surprise anymore, because they got the weaknesses and they got the strengths. And you will end up always with the same conclusion in a meeting like that. So yeah, it's... But still, I think, talking again about fairness, if it's part of the system that you have in your company, I think as a manager, you should spend time on it. You should take it seriously. So what I always did was, okay guys, we got this end of year review coming up. Can you please prepare it? And then we have the meeting. And I thought that was good. I mean, I expect people to take up the responsibility so that they were prepared for that end of year review. So what happened? They don't prepare it. They don't care about it. So they're there and I ask, okay, how was your last year? How did you experience it? Okay, but what was the project that you liked? Phew, I don't know. I mean, that's a long time ago already. Okay, so then I start switching context and I go into the question mode. How did you like your team? How did you like this project? How did you like the company? How did you like this change? And I'm all doing all the hard work. And this happened over and over again. So I thought, okay, I need to change this. Because, yeah, I'm doing all the hard work and I believe that also managers should be lazy. So that's not going to happen. So what I did at one time, I took Gallup's questions and I asked those questions. I said, you don't have to prepare anything, just come to the meeting. And the guy asked, okay, do you know what is expected of you at work? Oh, that's a good question. I think so. Being a software developer. Yeah, but anyways, these 12 questions, they gave us some things to discuss. And it really gave us some insight in people. But you can't use this every year, because next year, do you know what's expected of you at work? Yeah, software developer. You will get the same answer again. So it works once, but it doesn't work again. So you need to change it. So I looked again at Manage 3.0, at improved dialogues. And improved dialogues is based on improv theater. Like short. So you're on the stage and your saying something and the other one on the stage has to reply to you in a positive way, and together you build up a story. I thought, okay, this is a great way to do it. So there are some cards in the book. So for example, one of the cards that you can take from a stack of cards on the table is "The way I've been surprised is." Okay, and I thought this will be fun, this is important for me, this will be fun, this will be, we can use those cards over and over again, every year I'm done. So this was what I had in mind. "The way I've been surprised is," that's the question that I would ask from the cards, and the developer would say, yeah, that we were able to release in time. It was a few years ago, we're not talking about continuous development. Okay, and then I would say, okay, but we also release with any major issues. Yeah, true. And the investment, he would say, the investment in test automation really paid off. Yeah, that's true. Thinking about it, we should implement this framework in the other projects. And then he would say, that's a good idea. I would like to take up that task. I thought, hey, that's cool. This is how we're going to do it. Unfortunately, reality is a bit different. I said, "The way I've been surprised is," and she said, I don't know. But I mean, what surprised you this year? I don't know. We did not qualify for the European Championship with the Dutch team. Yeah, okay. And then next card. "What I like about this job is," I don't know, "being software developer, doing cool stuff, that's what I like." Okay, it failed completely. Totally didn't work out. To finish this topic up, I don't believe in yearly review meetings. But you have to do them sometimes, so yeah. Be creative. Experiment with things. I tried this experiment, totally didn't work. Do I really need to change the format every year? Yes, you need as a manager. And it's hard work, you have to be creative, but nobody said management was easy. Oh yeah, and then HR requires me to fill in a form with predefined questions. We got that system, cloud solution, and we need to fill in all those questions, and I cannot use this. Yes, you can. There's probably some kind of memo in the end with notes, extra comments where you can fill this in, and otherwise just do it and send them an email. We got, I don't know, 10,000 euros divided by 100 and done. I said, that's not fair. I don't believe that every team member contributes the same to the company as other team members. I think there's a difference. I think some team members are more valuable than others. And yes, you should be careful by saying that. But I think now and then you should respect some people more than other people. So doing everybody the same bonus, I don't think is fair. Okay, HR had an idea. And they said, let's do management by objective. Let's talk about in January what they need to accomplish this year. And at the end of the year we can look back. And if they accomplish it, we can give a bonus. Okay. But if somebody works as a developer in a software team, then I already believe that the team is the smallest entity that you can make a bonus with and a target, not an individual. And how are you going to say what the developer tester needs to contribute to a release? I mean, in my opinion, it's just contribute, develop, and do what you are asked for, and be a craftsman. How do you set that in an objective? Don't believe in it. 6 guidelines for bonuses that you can use, and that we applied. Don't promise rewards in advance. So we're not going to say what you will get in advance. You don't know what you will get at the end of the year. Because if you know what you will get at the end of the year, some people will be a bit more visible at the end of the year than other people. Keep the reward small. If you can get a bonus of 10,000 euros at the end of the year, that's worth being creative and making sure that you're visible for some people. So reward continuously, not just once. Do it throughout the whole year, not only at the end of the year. Do it publicly, not privately. I mean, don't have to ask people on the stage, but getting a compliment and knowing that you got a compliment makes you feel good, probably. I mean, do it properly, publicly. Reward behaviors, not only outcomes. Sometimes we really tend to focus on, okay, what did you really accomplish last year? It's less interesting. If you constantly lived up to the company values and was an example in that, I think that's much more valuable. If he did a lot of experiments with new tools and he failed every time, but he learned a lot, I think that's much more valuable. So it's about the behavior. And the last one is about peers. I mean, set up a system that your colleagues can reward each other, not only the manager. But that's what we did, and we in the end set up CUDA boxes and CUDA walls. And a CUDA box is quite simple. It is a CUDA box. And we had three locations, one in Romania, one in the Netherlands, and one in the US. So we asked people at that location, can you create a CUDA box? How does it look like? I don't know, be creative. So every location had its own CUDA box. What we did then was CUDA cards. We just printed a stack of those cards, put it next to the CUDA box. And we said to the team members, to the department, guys, we're going to introduce CUDA box, CUDA cards. You can write the CUDA cards, give it to somebody else, put it in the box, write down why, and write down from whom. That's it. You don't need to write your name. You don't need to... I mean, that's it. And you will get people will get a small reward. If you're going to abuse the system, then we're going to stop it. So let's try it out. I also asked people, can you create a CUDA card wall in your location? So we also had three CUDA card walls. And when somebody got a CUDA card, we checked it every week, the box. We printed it out, so here's your one, and that should also be somewhere here, and also here, I think. No, that's a different one. But that's how we did it. And we connected a voucher. 25 euros, $30, and 60 lei in Romania. So people got a CUDA card, a small voucher. And this really worked well. In the end, we stopped using the old bonus system. We just added the money to the regular salary increase because the new system gave much more value than the old one where the manager in the end said, okay, here's your salary, your bonus in a small room. This was much more valuable for the company. To finish up, I have doubts about some CUDA cards. Yeah, I sometimes saw CUDA cards that I thought, yeah, man, come on, is this worth the CUDA card? It's not up to you as a manager to decide about that. If people want to give each other a CUDA card, they give each other a CUDA card. And if I give a CUDA card because you, I don't know, did you just clean the dishes, then it's a CUDA card worth. I mean, you took the effort to write a CUDA card, so period. So what if people give each other CUDA cards? I give you a CUDA card, you give me a CUDA card, we got both 25 euros. Yeah, could happen. But if that's going to happen in your company, I think you got a bigger problem. I think you got a completely other problem, and you need to work on that. Yeah, I tried this, it didn't work. I hear this very often. Yeah, I know, doesn't always work. True. It's an experiment, just like what I did with the improved cards. Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't work. Try it again in 6 months, in a year. People will change, organizations change, and maybe it will work. Can a manager get a CUDA card? Yes, why not? I mean, isn't that not a great compliment that you get a CUDA card from your employee because you did something great? I mean, why not? Yeah, we need to learn. But wait, customer calls. And a small company, you learn, you play around with new technology, with new tools, then you deliver your product, and the first customers come in, and the first customers start calling, and you don't have time, and then you end up again with legacy software, and oh, we need to help the customers, and learning ends. How are you going to create again a learning organization? I mean, I've encountered it many times as a manager. One of the things was create your own personal development plan. So you create your own plan, I will provide you a template, come to me in May, and then we'll discuss it, and I will provide you the tools and whatever you need. It doesn't work. People don't have time, people need to do their regular work, and they forget about it. A few of them did it, but most people, they forget about it. Classroom training. Yeah, we did it. We hired a trainer. We had to make a migration to .NET from VB6 for some developers. I said, okay, lead by example, so I will also participate. I started in 1997 as a Delphi developer, so I did this workshop. And it was a bit embarrassing for the other ones, but I was in the top three of people when we did the exam. So I learned a lot. I learned that .NET is also coming from Delphi. It was fun, but actually for the company, it did not provide any value because people were not showing up because they had finished their project. They were sick, they were on holiday, they were not motivated. Why should I do this? I'm still working at VB6. HR had an idea. Discuss in the end year review. And then you can set goals for the next year. But as soon as the next year starts, people will forget about that year end of year review meeting. They don't care about it. So it didn't work. What we did was exploration days. Exploration days are familiar to hackathon days. Who knows hackathon days? Yeah. So you get 24 hours to deliver something, and the team or the project or the person that delivers the most valuable thing for the company gets a small reward or a big reward. But we looked at 6 rewards, so it should be small. But there's one main difference with exploration days or with this concept, is that you're not going to value the person who delivers the most valuable solution. You're going to value the person who learned most, or the team. It's about learning. It's not about delivering. So you set it up just like a hackathon. People can come up with their own projects. They can form groups. They can invite people. They can promote it. They can attract other people. And in the end, they're going to show what they've learned. And that's really fun. And if somebody proves to me that Angular 2 is a great framework, yeah, okay, that's nothing new. That's not surprising. But if you take something from the open source world and you prove that it's also working, or maybe better, that it's not working, I think then you learn something. And that's much more valuable. So it's all about learning. And I need a small gadget for the team who learn most. I got the question last week, but how do you know who learned most? How are you going to measure that? We're just going to vote with the team, with the people who are there in the meeting room in the exploration. It's just vote. So with this company, what happened? We did it. A lot of people attended. We really had to promote it because they were not that into, because yeah, they were busy, but in the end they attended. Some testers started, an expertise group on Thursday evening talking about Selenium. We had some people who took some time during those exploration days to look into security, and they found some really big security issues. And they continue doing that now and then. So that was really valuable. Important as a manager, lead by example. I also participated. I'm a big fan of Chromebooks, so I took my Chromebook to the office, Windows corporate environment, and used my Chromebook in that environment for 24 hours. What did I learn? Don't do it. It's not ready yet. So to finish up, you need to find some people who really promote this, because as I said, people are busy. They don't want to learn. They want to learn, but they don't think they got the time for it. So you need to find people who can really help you. You need to promote it, and really drag the people into the exploration days. Practical, sharing the results can take a while. You want to give people a stage to share the results. It can take a while. If you got 6 people, 6 teams, 10, 15 minutes, you're already 1 hour, 1.5 hour on the way. And as I said, you need to convince people, because they're used to firefighting and they think, yeah, but the product owner will not allow us to do this. Things like that. Okay, that's it. Yeah, feedback will be that I got too much stuff. Yeah, so what did I learn over the years as a manager? I think this is most important, that's trust. It's so hard to trust people. And maybe I just speak for myself, but as a manager, as a team lead, you need to trust your people. But that's so hard. But if you can do that, if you can give them trust, if you can give them the freedom, they can really do great stuff. The other one that I learned, yep, it broke it, is about Spotify. Who knows the Spotify model? Yeah, there he is. Yeah, it did. A lot of companies are implementing the Spotify model now, and they said it's great. It's not a model, but anyways. If you look at the things that I did, that I shared in my book, great stuff, but it won't work for you. Because you need to come up with your own model. As you cannot also, you can't use the Spotify model, you need to create your own model. You need to experiment, try things out. You can get inspired by the book that I wrote. You can get inspired by Manage 2.0. You can get inspired by Spotify model, but you have to find your own way. So that are the lessons learned. And you just need to keep experimenting, trying things out, and learn. And that's the fun part. I mean, as a developer, you need to learn, as a tester, but also as a manager, you need to keep learning and keep experimenting. Thank you very much. I hope you enjoyed it. Any questions? Another surprise, huh? yeah. Okay, I will be here all day. If you've got any questions, you can always reach out to me. If you want to link with me on LinkedIn, also fine. You can always drop me an email. I hope you enjoyed it. I wish you a lot of fun today. Enjoy the beers. I will. And see you later.